Hi, so we are in Penguin office and I am with Dr. Shashank Shah, the author of The Tata Group. And today we're just going to have a conversation about this book. This book has been doing very well. We published it less than a month back and we are already in the second reprint. Shashank, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Lohit. It's wonderful being here at the Penguin headquarters in Gurgaon.
So, quick question for you. So there are over a dozen books on the Tata Group.
Right.
So then why one more?
Right, good question. I've been doing a lot of book signings in the last couple of weeks, and this is the question everybody asks me. I think it's important to note that the Tata Group is not just a company, but it's a conglomerate with 100 companies. Mm. And the last major book that captures the entire Tata story was Creation of Wealth by late R.M. Lala. Mm-hmm. Who was a business historian, journalist, and also a Tata insider. Mm-hmm. That was in 1992, a quarter century back. That was just around the time when liberalization was setting in. The previous year, the Narasimha Rao budget facilitated the introduction of LPG. And the Tatas were at a cusp. A lot has happened in the last 25 years. Tatas have grown 25 times in these 25 years. From a revenue of 20,000 crores to a revenue of over 6 lakh crores. That's a phenomenal growth. Mm. They've also grown from being a predominantly Indian company to almost a global conglomerate, and India's largest global conglomerate, with over 66% of its revenues coming from outside India.
Okay.
And none of this is captured in any major book in the last 25 years, because this happened in very recent times. So I thought it was time to work on something which will fill that gap. Tata is also in some way India's pride, because it's a 150-year-old group. We are celebrating the 150th year. So it was a fascinating time and opportunity to do a win-win on both the sides.
So talking of a 150-year-old group, why not do a book on a new age company like a Flipkart or an Ola? Why a company which has been around for 150 years, and why is this company still interesting?
Personally, for me as a researcher, the Tata Group has been very interesting because of the model of business, or the structure they have. And permit me a minute or two to explain that. Very few people know the Tata structure. So there's a three-layered structure. At the base are 100 Tata companies. You have about 29 of them publicly listed, and the remaining 71 are privately held. These 29 listed companies have ownership between 30 to 70% by Tata Sons, which is the holding company. And the remaining 71 have 100% because they're privately owned. The Tata Sons, in turn, is owned by Tata Trusts. 66% of Tata Sons is owned by Tata Trusts. And the Tata Trusts are public charitable trusts which are mandated to spend 85% of their earnings for public good and social welfare. Now, 30 to 70% of the Tata company's dividends and 100% of the privately held company's dividends go to Tata Sons. And 66% of Tata Sons dividend go to Tata Trusts. 85% of them are plowed back into the society. Mm. So this is a model of business which is perpetually going to create wealth, not for its owners, but for society through this structure. And it's been so for the last 100 years. It's going to be in perpetuity because that's a legal mandate of the trust. So I feel this kind of resonates with the ideal of trusteeship that I very personally hold on to. It's been there in the scriptures. It was talked a lot about by Mahatma Gandhi and several other scholars of East and West both. Here is a model which tangibilizes it. But it is not only a do-good company, and let me come to that. So very often the book was launched at the Tata Lit Fest. The cover launch was at Tata Lit Fest. And there the whole series of questions were around, oh, Tatas are great, the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, the Tata Memorial Hospital, the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, the Institute of Science, phenomenal contribution to society. Great, they have and they continue to do. But what is also interesting to know is that while this model facilitates a lot of contribution to social good, about 2,000 crores every year as of now, the Tata Group itself has been a great wealth creator, which is a very less discussed topic. We did an analysis, and I've included in the group, between 92 and 2017, post-liberalization, we took 16 Tata companies and equally divided a notional investment of 1 lakh across. And we analyzed the kind of returns they have created for the shareholders. We were quite surprised to know that while the Sensex and Nifty companies gave about 10 lakhs to that 1 lakh of investment, the Tata companies, 16 of them, gave 40 lakhs.
Mm.
We also compared them with the best groups in India and overseas. The Tatas created more wealth than Aditya Birla and Reliance Group, and the Tatas created more wealth than Siemens, GE and Mitsubishi, the large conglomerates of Japan, Europe and America. And the Tatas created more wealth for shareholders than Berkshire Hathaway, which is the baby and the brainchild of the phenomenal Warren Buffett. Mm. So this is another aspect which isn't known, that it is possible to be doing well by doing good. So I spoke how they are doing good, but they are also doing phenomenally well. This book captures both these facets, how they have done phenomenally well and how they continue to do good over the last 150 years.
So, you know, let's speak of doing good, because the company itself has been looked at as an honest company. But can you really be an honest company? Can you be an honest company and do well during when country was under the British? Can you be an honest company and do well pre-1991 and then post-1991? So is it really possible to have these very different circumstances?
Yeah.
And still be honest, but do well.
Right. Good question, because it covers very different time frames. So actually the book and Tata's and India for that matter has gone through these four distinct phases, I would say. One is the British Raj, one is post-independence, one is pre-liberalization, and one is post-liberalization. And in each of these four phases, the Tatas have been India's leading company, almost number one for the last 100 years for sure. Under the British years, whether it's possible to doing well by doing good or follow the Tata way of business, as they say, there are several examples, whether it was in terms of getting permissions, whether in terms of pioneering new industries, whether it was in terms of consolidating that base in a new industry, whether it was in terms of getting permission from the government to establish an endowment for an institution of higher learning in India. So very few people know that Jamsetji Tata kept aside 50% of his wealth for his two sons, Dorabji and Ratan Tata, and 50% of his wealth for an endowment for the Indian Institute of Science. At that time, Lord Curzon, who was the head of the Indian Dominion under the British government or the British Raj, was not in favor of permitting the establishment of the ISC. So Jamsetji Tata interacted with Lord Hamilton in Britain, had several meetings with Curzon. They were somehow very concerned about the need for it, and hence the kind of investment the government would have to make along with the Tatas. He kept aside that money, left an endowment. The thing wasn't started in his lifetime. Almost a decade later, that money was used and the ISC began. So there has always been this idea of engaging with the government and have been very committed to their larger vision. And today ISC is among the topmost universities in Asia, Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, 100 years later. In the post-British period, in the independence, post-independence period, I'd like to share, there were several examples in the License Raj where the Tatas had to wait long years. I have captured a story.
Aviation is one of them. Yeah.
Of course, there have been a lot of Tata companies that were nationalized. The insurance company was nationalized. The banking company was nationalized. The aviation company was nationalized. In the 50 years post-independence, Tata Steel got permission only once to expand their capacity from a 1 million ton production to a 2 million ton production, at a time when Japan was having a production capacity of over 100 million. In the post-World War period, over 50 years, they expanded to 100 million. Tata Steel, India's largest steel company, was around 2 million tons because the government just wouldn't give permission. And Tata's played low and engaged with the government. Another example is of a fertilizer complex, which is very noteworthy. Not many know. In 1967, Darbari Seth, the managing director of Tata Chemicals, and JRD had proposed a comprehensive fertilizer complex for Tata Chemicals in Mithapur. Shrimati Indira Gandhi had come down to see the plan and visit the campus at Mithapur, and she was very happy with the idea and said, "I'll give permission." Would you believe, or can you take a guess, how many years it took before that fertilizer complex actually saw the light of day?
27 years, right.
From 67 to 94, they waited for a series of permissions through the bureaucratic labyrinth of the government a lot of it during the License Raj era, and just after liberalization, the factory finally came up, not in Gujarat, but in Babrala in Uttar Pradesh, because the government thought that was an underdeveloped area and Tata should take up the responsibility to do it. Now, Babrala was a godforsaken town where they couldn't even, the employees couldn't even house their wives with them. It was so difficult and inhabitable in the formative years. But they did. Today, Babrala is one of the finest industrial townships in that area. But 27 years and patience, no shortcuts.
Got it. Let me give you an example of something very opposite that happened, which is Tata Finance.
Right.
Where things actually went wrong.
Right.
And there was fraud that was committed.
Yes.
Tell me about that story and tell me how, it was quite interesting how Ratan Tata then decided to deal with the entire issue.
Yes. So Dilip Pendse, who was the managing director of Tata Finance, was quite a star performer, and Tata's had quite a lead in the banking and financial sector. They would have been at par with HDFC and ICICI because they had started at that time. But there were some kind of investments, rogue investments, speculative investments, which turned bad by Dilip. And eventually a lot of fudging of accounts and all of that was happening. When the fact came to the notice of the Tata leadership, they inquired. And unlike other companies, especially overseas, where these matters are shoved under the carpet, and of course we have the examples of Satyam in India as well, where there was a lot of delay and dilly-dallying over half a decade before Raju himself came out with the facts. Within a couple of months or a couple of weeks, I think, of the thing coming to their notice, they themselves ordered an inquiry and found out that there is a fraud. And they handed over the case to the police, went all the way to the CBI and told them to take the strictest action possible against the company.
When you say they, you mean?
The Tata board, Tata Sons, held by Ratan Tata. Dilip Pendse was sacked. The senior leadership team was sacked. They put a temporary team in place. And Tata Finance was not a Tata Sons 100% ownership company. They could have said, this is another company, standalone company. We are 30-35% owners. We'll take up responsibility to that extent. They had a few lakh retail depositors. They could have just said that when your deposits mature, we'll repay. They said, no. Even if your deposits are maturing 2 years later, if you want the money today because you're not sure about our existence, we will return the money back to you. Tata Sons kept aside 500 crores for repaying the retail depositors. You'll be amused. They had even kept a helicopter in service to transport money from their headquarters to wherever the outlets were so that the people can get the money. And interestingly, there wasn't a run on the bank, as is the case in most of these kind of situations. And a small percentage of people withdrew their money and then invested back eventually. Tata Finance was shut down. It was a part of it was merged into Tata Motors. And 5 years later, they came up with a new company called Tata Capital with a new leadership and a totally new mandate. So there have been blips. I think management or business organizations are not foolproof. There's a saying in Gujarati, but I'll translate in English. Crows are black all over the world. It's not that American crows are white. So human beings and organizations led by human beings are prone to faults and limitations. But what is the important thing is, how do you rectify your mistakes? Mm-hmm. Or if you have made one, how do you ensure that you don't repeat it?
And how do you take risks? So I'm actually a little mystified by this move that Tata Motors did to go and acquire JLR. And you know, I couldn't understand the business case of it.
Yes.
It was Tata Motors was struggling at that time, was not doing very well.
Yeah.
They were not in the high-end segment. JLR was failing and was owned by Ford.
Yes.
And people said, I mean, what's wrong with them? If Ford cannot turn around JLR, what makes Tata think that they will go and turn it around?
Yeah, wait.
What made them go and do that?
Yeah, so one thing I would say is, as several newspapers have also pointed out, it was sweet revenge. Mm. Because there's one story, and I've written about it in the book. When IndyCar did not do very well in its first version of the car, out of concern about the sustainability of the passenger vehicle business, the senior Tata team, including Mr. Ratan Tata, had visited the Ford headquarters in Detroit and had offered to sell the passenger vehicle business to Ford. But the Ford people were not very courteous, and they kind of told them that if you didn't know how to run a passenger vehicle business, why did you venture into it in the first place? quite demeaning and disturbing.
And when you say four people who...
The four top leadership. In such a conversation between Mr. Ratan Tata, I'm sure it would have been an equivalent leader at the Ford and probably their CEO or the managing director, because you have a group chairman flying into Detroit. And then they decided that, no, we have to prove them wrong. We know how to do a business. We'll just tighten our, tie up our sleeves and tighten our belts, and the rest is history. They came out with a newer version of Indica, and they turned around. They had made a 500 crore loss, which was the largest any company had made in India. In fact, very few people know that Ratan Tata had volunteered at their shareholders meeting to resign, saying that I take up the responsibility for this mistake and I will resign if you think, but let me promise you, if you give me one more chance, I will make a difference.
This was 1997.
This was 97, 98, yes. And as a result of that, they turned around in less than 2 years, made good the loss, and they came out with a new car. And it was a great success, a million cars sold, etc. Coming back to the JLR story, because they were in the passenger vehicle business, they realized that it's an opportunity to expand the spectrum of offerings that they have. Now, it's extremely difficult to manufacture high-end cars in India. While very few people know that Tata Motors had a joint venture possibility with Mercedes in the 1950s,
and with the Hondas
in 70s and 80s, much before Maruti came into the picture. But at both the times, the government and legislation did not permit them to establish. If we would have had Tata Motors making Mercedes cars in India in the 50s, you know where the automobile scenario of India would have been, right? So they said that it will be very difficult to manufacture high-end cars in India with the kind of R&D limitations we have, the patents, etc. And at that time, Ford had made about $15 billion of losses on JLR.
It was taking the entire group down.
Yes, and they were struggling to keep afloat. So they decided to sell off JLR because a huge portion of their losses were from Jaguar and Land Rover. That's when Tatas realized that they were already on a globalization spree, and they thought it would be far more sustainable to go for acquiring an international company for luxury cars, because India doesn't have a reputation for making luxury cars. So they ventured, bid for, and successfully at $2.3 billion acquired Ford, a JLR from Ford. And in fact, at that time, Ford chairman told Ratan Tata that, thank you, your Tatas are almost doing a favor to Ford by taking JLR from us. So those people who said Tatas may not know how to run a passenger vehicle car business, you are saying that you've done a favor to us by taking. But what is important is in the subsequent couple of, and then the global financial doom descended. When the markets were at its the markets were at its low. But then they were very, very hands-on. And of course, the concern in Britain was that Tatas will strip off all the assets and factories and make it a real estate project and take all the factories and products and everything back to India. But and some there was a spicy rumor that Tatas will open tandoori chicken restaurants all over. That Mr. Ratan Tata had mentioned that in an interview to a Harvard Business School magazine. So JLR didn't do any of that. The acting CEO of Tatas didn't do anything of that. The acting CEO of JLR was retained as the CEO of the new company. Mr. Ratan Tata assured that the ownership has changed, but JLR remained proud Britain European brands. And what he did was he engaged proactively. Every month he would visit the JLR factories in Britain and spend time with the workers, with the young managers, the engineers, the designers, and get to know from them the kind of ideas they have, what new products they can work on, how they can cut down on cost, etc., etc. The people on the shop floor had never seen a single director of Ford ever visiting them. And here was a group chairman spending a day every month. So there was a lot of hands-on involvement. There was a very young team working on cash management, inventory management, and new product development to kind of rise above the financial gloom of 2008. And there was a lot of focus on developing areas. So China, which accounted for 1% of JLR sales, started contributing to 20% of JLR sales. So they ventured into newer areas. He went with the CEO of JLR to all the dealerships in America, Mr. Ratan Tata, to see what we can do for you, how we can learn from you, how we can collaborate. So I think this hands-on approach is what has been the success of secret of success, the secret sauce, as they say. And I think in India, that's the uniqueness. The senior management does not consider themselves as a James Bond 007 kind of a hero who can operate from helicopters and solve problems. You have to be on the shop floor like JRD would do, like Jamsetji Tata would do, and like Ratan Tata did. Because that's when you develop that one-on-one rapport with the CEO, with the employees.
Got it.
I'll give you an example. Yeah. In Tata Steel, when they were going through tough times and the employees were having some kind of a salary cut, Dr. Irani, who was the CEO and MD of Tata Steel, did not buy a new car for his entire tenure of 10 years. He took upon voluntarily a kind of cost cutting for himself and only used company cars. He said, I will also contribute in a notional way so that the employees think that there isn't cost cutting only for them. Even the managing director is taking a cost cut.
Yeah,
unlike in US, yeah, where the CEOs took huge pay rises for them even in the financial gloom.
Yeah.
And there was a
and the company shut down,
customers took huge losses. So I think this is what distinguishes them.
I need to ask you a few very quick questions, and these questions you have to respond very quickly.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's like almost like a rapid fire. So I'll start. Where do you do most of your writing?
On my study table. I am not the kind who writes at airports and waiting in the lounges. I need silence. I need to get into the mood. I listen to some inspirational music or some inspirational speeches, read up something, and then when I'm in the mood, I start writing.
Okay. Before I ask you more questions, just to sort of tell people and give them more context. So we spoke about the book, and there's a lot of interesting things in the book.
Yes.
So I was going to, you know, for example, 2611, what happened there,
yes,
and Air India,
yes,
and how Air India used to be. You know, you told me Cathay Pacific and Singapore Airlines came to study how Air India works.
Yes.
And
Singapore Airlines and Cathay
happened.
Pacific came to study how Air India works under JRD Tata's chairmanship.
Yeah.
And interestingly, and I should mention this because it's Facebook Live, and I've covered the entire aviation story, and there have been 3-4 newspapers who've reported from that in the current aviation story that's happening with Vistara and Jet Airways and all Air India and all of that. 4 successive governments blocked Air India's entry into the aviation space. In fact, there's a conversation between an industry leader and Mr. Ratan Tata on an airline where that industry leader asks Mr. Ratan Tata, after all that minister was asking you for just 15 crores, you could have paid him off and got your license. You would have made that money within the first few weeks. So Ratan Tata replies, if ever I had to pay in order to get into a business, I wouldn't like to get into it. Because I would come back at home and sleep with the guilt that I have succumbed to pressure. Finally, Vistara and Air Asia India were launched in 2014-15. Today, they have about 7-8% market share. Though Air India was Tata Airlines in 1932. And today, both Air India and Jet Airways are trying to court Tatas to acquire them. Because both of them are in financial difficulties.
Sure.
Air India has a 50,000 crore worth of debt. And Jet Airways has defaulted. In fact, it is often said that Jet Airways leadership was from behind the scenes preventing Tatas from entering the air aviation space. Today, Jet Airways is looking up to Tatas as one of the prospective buyers, and Tatas will rescue Jet Airways out of the morass they have landed themselves. So I would say in the Indian scheme of things, how karma works,
yeah,
and the karma circle comes full circle. It's like 25-30 years.
Got it.
It's like that. So there are lots of these stories. There are lots of these fascinating insights. I've interviewed about 100 senior leaders. By the way, I'd like to clarify, this is not a commissioned book. A lot of people ask me, did Tata's commission you to write this? No. This is an outcome of a decade of research at my end, PhD, postdoc, and my stay at Harvard University and Harvard Business School. I've interviewed 100 senior Tata leaders, right from Mr. Ratan Tata down to factory leaders. I have interacted, referred to about 1,500 references and visited their archives, factory locations, Pune, Jamshedpur. So it's a bird's eye view, and it's also the caterpillar's eye view, I would say, to the whole group, the entire group, and about 20-25 Tata companies.
Now for some questions for readers to know you and,
yes,
and
sure,
how you function.
Sure.
So hence I'm going to go
sure
quickly over some questions. What made you so interested in the genre of business books? What is so great about this genre, and why would you recommend it to somebody?
Yeah, I think business books are not just about business. Business itself is an amalgamation of several fields of study. Anthropology, leadership, a lot of sociology, a lot of sustainability and natural resource management. All of these varied fields come under the umbrella of business. And in order to do well in business, you need to be doing well in all of these, because there's a saying, men are more valuable, or human beings are more valuable than all the wealth of the world. Because amongst the six M's of business, M for man or human beings gives value to the other five, which is material, money, machines, methods, and minutes. So the six M's of business are valuable because of the human element in that. And businesses are most misunderstood as money generating machines. People don't realize, and as a student and researcher and author and teacher of business management, that capitalism, when used in its ideal and most productive essence, can play a very big role in fueling the engines of growth of any economy. And the means to do that is through taxation. The Tata Group alone contributes 4% of India's GDP and 2.25% of its tax collections.
Wow.
In 2017, Tata's paid 47,000 crores as tax, which is equivalent to the tax collected by an entire state like Andhra Pradesh.
Mm.
And this money is eventually going to be used for you and me, yeah, by government, road, yeah, construction, healthcare, education. So in order to use business well, you need to give them the freedom to explore new industries, diversify and grow. And you need to have a very strong taxation, transparent taxation system, which takes a part of that for social and nation building. And if that is done well, which I see now India getting into transparency at both ends, then the amount of resources that will come into use for you and me is going to be phenomenal. And for people to understand that, business books are a good genre to understand how businesses are conducted inside leading companies. Each one of us is a Tata consumer. 65 crore people consume Tata. Tata Salt, Tata Pulses, Tata Tea, yeah, Tata Tea Coffee in the morning, Tata Cars, Tata Watches, Tata Perfumes, everything.
Mm.
But we don't know what's happening inside Tatas, right?
Mm.
So it's a very good way to know how these businesses are run and how you can effectively be a good entrepreneur, a good manager, a good leader in whichever profession you may be.
Sure.
And that's possible by making it accessible. Till now, business books are looked at very technical and theoretical.
Yeah.
This is a story book, and that's what most business books are today. That's
actually
my attitude.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. You say most business, even most great business books are great stories, actually.
Yes.
Which was the first business book that inspired you?
Built to Last.
No, Jim Collins.
Jim Collins. I was in college that time, and I really was fascinated. In fact, my PhD is inspired by Built to Last and Good to Great.
Mm.
And my previous book, Win-Win Corporation, which is also a Penguin publication, is an Indian version of Good to Great.
Mm.
In fact, you may remember we were going to name it Good and Great,
yeah,
but then we said we don't want to call it Good and Great. We called it Win-Win Corporations.
Is writing energizing or exhausting for you?
It's very fulfilling.
Mm.
But it's also very draining, because at the most you can write about 3 or 4 pages a day. And people don't realize that non-fiction writing, especially rigorous writing, insightful writing, needs to be very, very, you need to be very thoughtful of what you're writing. Of late, I have personally seen a lot of opinionated books. You pan someone or you praise someone sky high. You do not provide multiple perspectives on the subject. So that it's not only your perspective, it's several perspectives and your perspective on that. Because the reader is referring to your book to understand an identity, an individual or institution. If you're going to give your opinions and not do that, you're doing a disservice as an author. And hence I feel that needs to be done, and that makes it very rigorous and hence exhausting. But extremely fulfilling. Often writing a book or seeing your book in your hand is like giving birth to a baby. So that's the closest parallel very often several authors draw. So it's a very satisfying experience.
What are the most important magazines and books that you would recommend to somebody who wants to read business and stay up to date with what's going on?
I think some of the leading Indian magazines, when I was in college, I used to read Business India a lot. That's one magazine. I'm a consulting editor now, but not because I'm a consulting editor. But in those years,
I was about to ask you.
Yeah.
The same thing.
Yeah. No, but I am consulting editor now, just 6 months back. I know, just about a year or so back. But why I'm saying that is Business India did that. They didn't provide journalistic articles.
Mm.
I mean, just facts and opinions. They provided well-rounded perspectives, which we usually see in management journals. And I'm a management researcher, so I'm used to writing for management journals of IIMs, or even for that matter, Harvard Business School Publishing and several others where I've written. But magazines don't have that rigor. In Business India, I've seen that rigor. So that's one magazine. Of course, Business Today, Business World are all good. In terms of books, I would personally recommend for beginners, youth, to read biographies of successful companies.
Okay.
There are books on Google, Microsoft, and several Indian companies, Godrej Group, Infosys, Wipro. That will give you a feel of what it takes to build an organization, what it takes to nurture that organization, and what it takes to sustainably maintain that levels of success. Like someone asked me, what are the three factors of a good leader? And since that's the question, I said, one, a leader needs to be visionary. Second, a leader needs to be creating an enabling ecosystem to facilitate that vision. And third, the leader needs to lead by example and walk the talk. This you will get from business biographies.
Got it. How many hours went into writing this book?
This book was a product of 10 years of my data collection interactions with several Tata leaders. In terms of writing, I would say it was like almost full-time writing for about 9 months, 8 to 9 months.
Okay. What is the hardest thing for you about writing?
The hardest thing for me about writing is writing my own opinion.
Okay.
Because as a management researcher, I'm not trained to be opinionated. I'm trained to be observant about others' opinions and derive insights out of that.
Okay.
Trade books require you to give your own opinion and not just limit it to an insight. Moving from a management research to a trade publication, that I think is what I'm learning to do.
Especially if you have an editor who keeps pushing you.
Yes. and that's the job Lohit has done, and we work now for 2 books.
Yeah.
And we've almost co-created the vision for both these books because he brings that experience and I bring my management research experience.
And a fair amount of pesky behavior as well. If you gave up writing, what career path would you choose?
I think my career, so I wouldn't say writing is my career. Writing is my passion because I'd like to share these ideas that I have, that I espouse with a larger audience, as I have dedicated this book to crores of Indians who want to build a nation with ability and nobility.
Mm.
I think I'd like to do that part, to build India with ability and nobility, and see how I can use my ideas and my competencies to contribute to this nation, which is about to become the third largest economy in the world.
What were the last books that inspired you? And business or outside business?
I read a lot of spiritual come autobiographical books, so I wouldn't be able to highlight one.
Mm-hmm.
But I've read the lives of several great saints of India. Ramana Maharishi, Sai Baba, Paramahansa Yogananda, Vivekananda, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, all of these. And I've also read autobiographies of political leaders, Dr. Kalam, Mr. Vajpayee, Mahatma Gandhi. So I've always been very inspired by personal accounts because it's not someone else's story about what they think. It's either their person's own writing or it's someone else's rigorous study about an individual or institution's evolution. And these are not fly-by-night kind of or overnight success stories. These have been nurtured, and the kind of pitfalls they have faced and the kind of successes they have achieved in spite and despite that is a real life situation which each one of us goes through. It's not the romanticizing of poverty or romanticizing of difficulty that we see in fiction novels. It's a real life story which each of us or each individual or institution goes through. And that I relate to more because I can learn from that. I ensure I don't make those mistakes, don't reinvent the wheel. And I learn some of the success stories which they have created.
Okay, I'll end this conversation with a lighter question. If you go to a dinner party, who would you like to be sitting next to?
Oh, I've had opportunities to sit for dinner with several eminent people. I had once a very wonderful opportunity of having my Diwali night dinner sitting next to the Dean of Harvard Business School.
Nitin Noria. Yeah.
We were discussing about my research and also from that you can guess I usually would like to look at or rather look forward to talking to someone who can share my passion. Discuss business, management, India. I'm very passionate about the India story. Politics, administration, corporations.
So two people. If you go to a dinner party and you got a choice, you got to pick, who would you sit next to?
Yes, I'd like to sit next to the Prime Minister and talk to him about his vision of India and how and what can be done and what my thoughts are and what he has to do about it.
Okay.
And the other person,
R&D.
I've already had a meeting with Mr. Ratan Tata because for the book I had interviewed him.
Yeah.
But someone of it, I would have loved to have a conversation, of course he's no more, with the late J.R.D. Tata. He was a fantastic man manager and iconic leader. the only Indian business leader to have got the Bharat Ratna. Mm. So these would be
good choices. So thank you for the conversation, and I want to end this on a simple note. The book is out there. It is absolutely captivating. It's a gripping read. Please go get a copy and enjoy reading the book. Thank you.
And do share your thoughts. I'm on Twitter at Dr. Shashank J. Shah. And I also have, I'm active on LinkedIn. And I also have a website where I upload all fact files, stories and all on the books, all my books. So shashankshah.com, you may want to visit that. Lots of tools, frameworks available for free download. Feel free to make the most of it. Thanks.